MediaShout users. We are recording today again from our offices here in Franklin, Tennessee. I am so happy today that one of my oldest and dearest friends in life, and just a wonderful, anointed worship leader, is here with me, Mr. Don Moen. He used to be president of Integrity Music, and like many of you who are going to be watching this video, he's probably one of the very first voices of worship that you heard growing up as a Christian, and he was for me. So when I first became a Christian in 1988, I started getting those Integrity Music cassettes in the mail, and Don's album was the album I would play over and over and over again, just being saved, you know, with that new fervor, but not knowing a thing about the Bible. And Don's music ministered to me and quieted my spirit and allowed me to commune with God in the most beautiful, beautiful ways. I love him to death. So Don Moen, welcome.
And it is great to be here. And we both flew in last night, you from Boston, me from Minnesota. So we're
clear-eyed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And drinking coffee. But yeah, it's exciting.
Thanks for coming.
When you think about all the things we've done over the years, we're really, really blessed.
When you think about all the things you've done in the years, I am amazed.
Yeah.
Well, we've done some wonderful things together,
yeah.
But, you know, Don won't say this, but I can say it. Don is, I believe, the father of modern worship music. He is the guy who brought it on to the scene and mentored so many of the great worship artists that came up, like Paul Balash and... from Hawaii.
There's
Bob Fitz.
Bob Fitz,
Israel Houghton.
Ron Canole.
Ron Canole.
Darlene Check.
Oh my God, Darlene Check. I mean, from the whole Hillsong, their first album you produced, didn't it?
Yeah, well, I was, my job at Integrity Music was kind of the, I did line produce some of the stuff, but the executive producer. So basically find the artists and find the songs. And you know, that's called A&R in the
artist and repertoire,
right? And it's, but we call it airports and restaurants, because that's pretty much what I did. Is, you know, somebody would call and say, "Hey, we got to you need to come and see what's happening at this church," and so I'd be flying every weekend somewhere,
right,
to hear somebody lead worship, and that those days. I realized if I found a church where God was really moving, you know, so really I was looking for moves of God.
Yeah.
And
that's
usually if I identified that, there were going to be, there's going to be a worship leader.
Right.
That's going to be harvesting all that stuff.
Because that really is the litmus test, isn't
right.
it?
I think so.
If the anointing is there, if the presence of God are there, it's not about their technique, or are they an amazing musician, or even sometimes the most amazing singer.
Right.
But if the anointing is there and they lead people into worship, that's the key, and it's rare.
Yeah. Yeah, that's, a lot of pastors, will, when I was at Integrity, they still do today, they call me and say, "We need a worship leader at our church.
Yeah.
Can you give us some names?" I said, "Well, how about you lead worship?"
Wow.
"Well, I'm not a singer." But I said, I'm not talking about being a singer.
Yeah.
You know, when a pastor sets the tone for worship in his church, the church really is a worshiping church.
Yeah.
Because it really comes down from the pastor.
Yeah.
If a pastor hires a worship leader, so, and he sits back there and doesn't engage, his church really isn't going to be a worshiping church. So pastor sets the tone. I remember doing one product with... we were going to do Live at the Potter's House with T.D. Jakes.
Uh-huh.
And we had done a project with him called Woman, Thou Art Loosed.
Of course. Everybody
Superdome.
Knows it.
And we were doing a follow-up, and it was going to be Live at the Potter's House in Dallas there. And Bishop Jakes was saying, "We need to get a whole bunch of people on this. Who else are we going to get?" I said, "Nobody, it's you." And he said, "Well, I'm not a singer." I said, I'm not talking about a singer. I said, you are a worshiper, so just set the tone. And you know what? That was a great project.
Yeah.
And Bishop Jakes just kind of set the tone.
So great.
And led worship on that project.
That was amazing.
It's a good example for, you know, all pastors.
Yeah.
And when it comes to, you know, your church being a worshiping church.
Yeah.
Set the tone, because that's the Lord just works that way. And if the pastor is a worshiping pastor, like I said, then the church usually is a worshiping church.
It is that mix, and it only comes from God, right? Mm-hmm. And that anointing and that ability. And our audience, as you know, is mostly people in the booth, the tech crew, the media crew, and communications teams. And often, you know, there's conflict between the pastor and the worship leader in a church, and sometimes conflict between the worship leader and the tech crew.
Sure.
And I suppose you have some amazing, amazing stories from the road about when it's gone really, really well in the tech booth and when it's not. What are some, I'm sure you've seen all kinds of things.
I have seen it all, Eric. Just when I think I've seen it all, I find something new. But the thing about the tech team, first of all, they're a unique group of folks.
Mm-hmm.
I get asked 6 months out from when I'm going to sing, somebody in the technical team is saying, can you give us your set list? And it drives me crazy.
Right.
Like, what are you talking about?
6 months out.
if you pray and ask the Holy Spirit, he'll tell you what I'm going to do. You know, put it back on them. But and my band kind of hates it too. Like, yeah, where's the set list? But I got people that are in the audiovisual department saying, we need your set list. I said, that's 6 months from now.
Yeah.
What? I don't know what I'm going to
sing. You don't know what the Holy Spirit's going to be doing.
Now I kind of say, I'll send them a list and say, I'll work from this list. And this is probably about 90%. When we get a little closer, I'll give you the thing. But, you know, it drives me crazy that there are people like that.
Yeah.
But those people, I've realized over the years, it's one of the most important roles in your church and in your worship team.
Yeah, because invisible but important.
They can sabotage a great sermon. They can sabotage your worship team. I'm talking about sound. I'm talking about
lights.
Putting up the wrong image, putting up the wrong, everything. And sometimes people that are in these departments are a little insecure, and they try to keep information from the rest of the people, because when the people see all these knobs and dials and stuff, they get intimidated. So, if you're going to be serving in that capacity, you really need to have a servant's heart, and don't make it all about you. I have a sound engineer I've traveled with for 20 years, and I always encourage him to write a book. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. I mean, but this is, you talk about the audio-visual portion of the church team. You guys and gals are using the latest technology, and your challenge is to not make it all about the technology. It's just to just use it as you need to enhance what the pastor is saying, to enhance what the worship team is doing, and keep an open hand. Do not get insecure and try to control those knobs and keep people out. If you have that attitude, you probably need to move out for 6 months and just take a break. But if you're in that position, you need to really have a servant's heart. And the thing is, nobody ever says thank you to you.
Right.
You don't really.
Nobody.
No, they don't get
They're
noticed.
Invisible.
Unless it's wrong.
Unless it's wrong.
And then everybody goes,
yes.
Wow, the words were completely wrong. Well, so that's it's a tough place to be, because you're not on the stage where everybody knows
right.
It's you, but you're sitting behind the scenes.
Unsung heroes.
And if it's work, you know, when it works, and nobody says anything to you, usually.
Right.
And it'd be nice if people come by and say, man, fantastic today. But they don't, because,
no.
So the when you know you did a good job is when
nobody says
anything. Nobody says anything. They leave the church and say, "Wow, we
it's the highest praise.
We connected in worship today, yeah. And it might have been an image at the right time, just the right light. Something it just worked, and the Holy Spirit used you to make it happen." Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a tough role to be in.
Yeah,
because you get no accolades.
None whatsoever. And that's what we love about our customers,
yeah.
Because they are unsung heroes.
Yeah.
And I think they do it week after week because they know they're contributing. And they're selfless in a lot of ways because they do it and don't need or want any praise. But just the way, and you've seen this a million times because I've watched you, just the way, like, say, when you travel with Lenny LeBlanc, the way Lenny and you are on the same spiritual thread, you're tuned into each other in the Holy Spirit, and you don't even have to speak. It's just, or the pastor is on the same, and suddenly you play a song, and his sermon comes forth out of that, and because the Holy Spirit's kind of directing everybody,
right?
And I believe that the Holy Spirit also directs the tech crew, and when you have tech crew that is flowing with the Holy Spirit and trying to, oh, he's going here, he's going there,
right.
Let's enhance that moment.
Well, and part of what a tech crew needs to do is earn the trust. You talk about pastor relationships.
Mm-hmm.
Same with the worship leader and the pastor, tech team and pastor.
Right.
You have to earn his trust.
Right.
And if you earn his trust, you know, that develops that
right.
flow. He knows you're going to have the right thing up
at the
right time.
Yes.
And same with the sound, same with the lights, all these things. And it also goes with the congregation. Part of our role, the tech team's role, is to earn the trust of the audience too.
Yes.
Because it's not going to be so obvious, but
it enhances.
Their trust is, yeah, that was, they walk out and they say, wow.
Yeah.
I that was so powerful. They can't maybe put their finger on what
right.
it was.
Yes.
But
the visual worship and the seamless kind of flow of lights and sound and visual and lyrics and makes a big, big difference.
And you can overdo it.
Yes.
Less is more. That's what I always tell people. If you're thinking about 20 ideas for this song, cut 10 of them out right away. And
mm-hmm.
I mean, just less, I think, is always a better call.
Yeah.
Just leave some room. Don't fill up. It's like a guitar player filling every single bar.
Yeah.
You do a fill, or a drummer filling every bar.
Exactly.
Same thing applies to the tech world. And the question is, how do you utilize the latest, greatest technology?
Yeah.
And not make it all about that.
Yeah.
You know, it's a challenge.
It is a huge challenge. I haven't been recently, but a volunteer in the communications team at Brentwood Baptist Church.
Mm-hmm.
And I love when I'm up in the booth with the director up there, and there's a director's booth for the cameras upstairs, and then downstairs there's a booth in the congregation, and they're doing lights and the media shout and all that stuff. But I love it when the director will anticipate what Mike Glenn, our pastor, is going to do, or the worship leader is going to do, and they'll say to all of us, "I think he's going to make a joke here, or I think he's going to do this, or he's going to move across the," and he has this already because he's anticipating. And that's so helpful and useful because it doesn't draw, it's seamless worship, and it doesn't draw any attention away from mediocrity or it just becomes a seamless thing.
Yeah.
And they have gotten to know Mike's patterns over years. Well, I want to talk all about your touring in a second, and I want to talk about all the great stuff you've done because that could be... I love, love, love all the stuff that you do. But if you could say something to all of the communications and tech teams and booth people around the world, what would you say to them?
I would just, before I said, you know, servant's heart is everything. Let's not lose focus of what we're there to do. Listen, people that come in, that are coming to your church, they don't need more pageantry. They don't really need more production. What they need is the presence of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not saying don't use all the technology. So I'm saying let's use the latest, greatest technology we have, but never lose sight of the fact that that's not what's going to change a person's life. What's going to change a person's life is God's presence. So your job, my job as a worship leader, your job in the audio tech, that whole side of the team, is to somehow ask the Holy Spirit to help you create an atmosphere with your images, with what you do, that allows people to connect with a living God. Help create an atmosphere that welcomes God's presence. Because if you do that, if we do that, people walk out of that event, their life will be changed forever. But if it's just all about images and production and all this other stuff, you might as well go to a show downtown in Nashville here.
Mm-hmm.
But so it's like, understand, never lose sight of the fact that the one thing people need is God's presence.
Yes.
So what can you do? That's why you need to be praying with your team.
Mm.
Ask the Holy Spirit to give you wisdom and
understanding.
You know, I tell churches a lot of time when I'm teaching about worship, I think is it Nehemiah chapter 8 or Nehemiah 6 or 8, when Ezra opened the scrolls and began to read the God's word, the people fell on their face and worshiped. No music, no, you know, it doesn't talk about all those things. So I say to people sometime, what would happen at your church if you arrived next week and there are no visuals, there's no drums, there's no piano, there's no guitar, nothing. Would you still worship? And I bet you would. People would be a little uncomfortable at first, but I think part of this is, let's never lose sight of the fact that why we are coming together. And God has given us so much. We got the internet, we got all these tech things, we got all this stuff. The danger we face is making it all about that. So don't do that. Make it all about the people connecting with a life-changing, powerful God. And we'll use all the tools we have to make that work. But the challenge is not to make it about. But if you're a real techie guy or gal, if you're totally a tech nerd, the temptation is going to be, oh, watch this effect. Oh, mm-hmm. my gosh, watch this, what I can do. And guess what? The people in the audience suddenly say, they're looking at, wow, what a cool effect. Wow. And they lose sight of the whole thing. That's the wrong way to do it. It's like a guitar player in a band making it all about them.
Right. And you can tell immediately
breaks
the worship.
It's not about you. So the challenge, because you're on that team, you probably love technology, but so all the more reason why you have to really ask the Holy Spirit for wisdom and not make it about the coolest move in the world. Because
unless the Lord leads you to do
something.
Yeah,
and even putting lyrics on the screen. Sometimes, you know, I used to sing a song a lot. I exalt thee, I exalt thee, I exalt thee.
Peter Sanchez.
Yeah,
Pete Sanchez,
but
right?
It's like three. It's how hard is that?
Yeah.
I exalt thee. But you know what? If the lyrics are on the screen, you know what I'll do? I exalt thee, exalt thee, I exalt thee, oh Lord, I exalt. Why do I do that? But see, people, we're just geared that way to just, you know, okay, there's an image, I got to follow it. But that's why it's so sensitive to take these tools that we have and use them sparingly so that it just, maybe there's a time to pull that lyric down. People, you know the lyrics. I would say to the worship leader, people know that lyric. Let's just sing that song. Pull the lyric down, do an image or something like that.
Yeah.
But anyway, sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. But
that's really good.
Don't serve the technology. Let the technology support
that's
the
great.
Ministry.
That is really, that was a really
long
good
answer excellent to a short question.
Well, that was excellent, excellent answer. Let's talk about you for a second.
Finally,
we get to talk about me.
Talk about you.
Yeah, right. Yeah, he's the last guy who wants to ever talk about himself. But I love it because, you know, I've watched your ministry over all these years, and it never fails. When you lead worship, the atmosphere of the Holy Spirit just flows. It just fills the room, and I'm lost in it. I'm just going to tell you right now, if your church wants a great worship experience, one from a wise and really the what I would say the godfather of modern Christian worship, call Don Moen Ministries. Have Don and his ministry team come in. How big are you, is your band now?
I'm doing a lot of solo dates too. The band usually we go with about 5 or 6 people.
So it could be anywhere from just Don to 5 or 6 with him, and is bigger than that if you wanted.
Oh yeah.
But I've seen Don with his worship team and Lenny LeBlanc with him, and it is spectacular. So I think my team's going to put the Don Moen website up. What is it called? DonMoen.com?
DonMoen.com.
That's complicated.
Has all the stuff. Yeah. That has everything you need, yeah.
And if you call the office, you're probably going to be speaking to one of Don's sons, either John or Michael, and they'll tell you everything, or email info@DonMoen.com. And it's easier than you think, and it's more accessible than you probably think. But it will inspire. I'm just telling you, I've been to so many. I've traveled by airplane. I remember when Sana and I came to see you in private jet,
yes,
in Virginia. You were with Michael W. Smith, mm-hmm, I think.
Yeah.
And it just never fails. Why? Because Don is humble. He has an anointing. And God, he honors God. And it's not about Don. If you want an evening that will just fill your church with the presence of God and have your entire congregation worshiping God, call them. Go to the website, DonMoen.com. And so, Don, let's get to... thank you for everything you've said about church presentation software and the people that run it. And I want to hear about your life and your history. But I think you had one other thing you wanted to tell.
Before I talk about me, which is my favorite thing.
I know you hate it.
No, but I just had another thought. You know, as far as when you talk about church presentation software and the teams involved in that, what you got to realize, because of the creativity of the creative aspect behind it, you're a perfect target for criticism. All right, so I want to encourage you, you know, because the right visual at the right time is so powerful, and the wrong visual at the wrong time is just as powerful in the opposite way. It's going to get some criticism from your pastor, from the people in your congregation. So I would really encourage you to keep an open heart and a teachable spirit. You may have new team members on your team that they're going to make a mistake, okay? Mm-hmm. They're going to put up the wrong image.
Yep.
They're going to put up the wrong lyric, the wrong font. Something's going to happen. And I would encourage you as a leader to kind of put your arm around that person and just lovingly say, you know what you did right here. And by the way, you need to be criticizing and analyzing what you do every week. You know, as a worship leader, every time I walk off a stage, I'm asking myself, what could I have done better? Mm. What worked and what didn't work? And I ask other people as well, what worked for you and what didn't work? And that's always hard because people are going to tell you, I didn't like this, I didn't like that. And if you're too subjective about it, it's going to hurt your feelings. And you have to, if you're going to be on that team, on that media team, you need to be able to be very objective about what you're doing, about your work. So almost put it on a table and like looking at this coffee cup, look at it from all directions and just be objective. Don't be a subjective, because your pastor needs to have, he needs to feel that he has permission to talk to you directly and say, I did not like the way the sermon points came up, the image came up, because I felt it distracted. Your pastor needs to feel that he can say that without tiptoeing around and worrying about hurting somebody's feeling. Another thing you need to understand about your pastor, I may be getting off track here, your pastor probably is a visionary.
Yep.
You talk about the personality profiles, the DISC, the DISC profile, whatever, or, you know, 90%, your strengths and weaknesses, 90% of pastors probably are visionaries. We're building this church, we're building this thing. And us little creative people, we're like, oh, God bless you, God bless you. What a great song, it's so fun. And our little feelings are so hurt when the pastor, you know, you spend all week working on a song, or you spend all week working on this perfect imagery, and pastor gets upset, no, I'm going a different direction, I'm gonna preach now. And it messes you up, and you get your feelings hurt. And I just really want to encourage you to get over that. If you're going to, this is a very creative field that you're in, and if you're going to have your feelings hurt every time somebody criticizes an image that you put up or the way you did it, you need to get on a different, you need to get out or get on a different team or something like that. So I really want to encourage you, keep a teachable spirit. If you're just new at this, just let your leader know that you want to learn. If you do something wrong, apologize, fix it.
Yeah.
You need to be analyzing after every service.
Mm-hmm. With your team.
What did we do that really worked?
Mm-hmm.
And as a team, they need to have the permission, without getting hurt feelings,
right,
to say, what worked for you guys? I didn't like that image. Why didn't you like it? I don't know. It just didn't connect with me. I mean, you need to have the permission to have that kind of conversation. Yeah, because that's what's going
to
make you better.
Yes.
And you're going to say, this really worked, this didn't work. We'll cut off the stuff that didn't work. Our objective is to make every single week be better and better and better. But you got to remain objective. Don't get so subjective about these things. Okay.
And whether you're running the church presentation software, you're running MediaShout, you're on the worship team, you are the worship leader, the pastor. Everybody has to be humble, right?
Right.
When you say humility is so key, because everyone has to be taking their cues from the Holy Spirit.
Well, who said it? Was it Ronald Reagan said, it's amazing what you can get done if you don't worry about who gets the credit.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, so that's the deal.
Yeah.
And part of being on this team is nobody may recognize you as like, oh, it was her, it was him. You know, do it unto the Lord.
Yeah.
Keep a humble, teachable spirit, and I think you'll be amazed at how God will use you. And
I watch, because I'm on the media team at Brentwood Baptist, I watch, when I watch any TV show or worship on service on TV, I'm aware of what the cameras are doing.
Oh, yeah.
You know, because, those people are never mentioned.
No. Nope.
But even a guy like Joel Osteen, you know, he used to be in the booth.
Right.
Right? He used to run all that stuff. And so he knows what it's like. And that's pretty seamless, you know, when you watch. But it takes a lot of work and a lot of people.
And the thing is, you've really, if you want to get your presentation to be seamless, a seamless presentation takes a lot of work. It doesn't just happen.
No.
The only way that happens is by doing analyzing what you did that worked, what didn't work, how can it become better, and
In our church, the stream, they live stream the service. People can go to the website and pull down the service and watch it anytime they want. But that has like the second largest audience of the congregation of any of our services. And nobody knows how much time, effort, energy goes into capturing that correctly and still preserving that worship. So, Don, let's talk about you. I know you don't want to, but I have watched Michael W. Smith stand up and give honor to this guy. I've watched the number of people that he's trained. And if you were around when Shout to the Lord came out, back in the day. That transformed the world. And Darlene is a very good friend of yours and someone I love very much. Paul Balazs, and I know he felt safe and you allowed him to grow and inspire him. And all of these wonderful worship leaders and artists, musicians that came through Integrity. That's a gift to nurture that talent. So tell us, how did it happen? Where were you? I know you didn't apply for the job, so this may be encouraging for those of you who are trying to follow God's plan for your life, because this wasn't in your plan, was it?
Oh, no way. My plan was to be I wanted to be a pilot, a Navy pilot, but I couldn't get into flight school because of my glasses. And so my backup plan was to be a forest ranger, because I like to hunt and fish. And so, and then I got a violin scholarship at a university to study. So I kind of went down that road. And long story short, I started to get interested in guitar and ended up at Oral Roberts University, Christian music, and started traveling with a group called Living Sound, who was Terry Law was the evangelist. And I thought I was getting on the bus for about 6 month tour, and 10 years later I got off the bus. But I learned a lot during those years.
So where you met your wife Laura, right?
Yeah, I met her at ORU.
Okay.
But we went on the road for 10 years. We did about three concerts every day. We did a school program in the morning, one in the afternoon, and a church or an auditorium at night. Three setups and teardowns. We were setting up all the gear, tearing it all down, and three times a day, and then we'd go home and sleep on someone's couch. I did that about over 300
Brutal.
Concerts, 300 days a year.
Oh,
we would do three concerts a day.
Brutal.
For 10 years. So that's like 1,000 concerts a year for 10 years, and after that, you get some of the rough edges knocked off.
Yeah.
And a lot of times, the challenge with the people today, with the technology we have,
mm-hmm.
you can create incredible art in a vacuum. It's just in a spare room of your house, you can produce an incredible album. But when you get on the stage, you got nothing to say.
Mm-hmm.
So part of what's important is developing your gifts, your communication skills. Get up there and understand your audience, and this is something to remember as well. Who is your audience? If your audience is a lot of gray hairs and older people, your images and all that you do needs to be tweaked a little bit. If it's a youth audience, it's another thing. So be aware of your audience. But yeah, so that's what I did for. I started touring and doing that, and I just knew there was something more about my music. That I wanted, and I had praying about it, and I wrote down these words: I want my music to come in power, praise, healing, and deliverance.
Wow.
I wrote those four words down. And
how old were you when you did this, and what year was
that? Was 1981.
Wow.
81. And I hadn't really led worship yet. I wasn't leading worship. So
you
I
were just in the band.
Yeah, I was just in the band, and I didn't like being in front of people.
Oh my gosh.
I just, there's no way I wanted to be up front
you
leading.
You didn't want
worship.
To be the lead guy.
No way. I failed my speech class at ORU because I couldn't give a speech in front of 15 people. That's how petrified I was. So the fact that I'm doing what I'm doing today is really
all
quite
over
a
the
miracle.
World.
If he did it for me, he can do it for you. So I was praying about my music. And in the middle of the night, I was awakened. One of the few times that I heard a voice say to me, open your Bible to Psalm 40, verse 3. And I got out of bed and I opened my Bible, and it says, I have put a new song in your mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and put their trust in the Lord. And I remember sitting there thinking,
so beautiful.
What just happened to me? And
word from
I
the
said
Lord.
To my wife the next morning, something happened to me last night, and I'm not even sure what it is, because I hadn't led worship, so it was still 2 years before I would lead worship. But
really, more years?
2 more years.
So God planted that seed.
Yeah, and so it was kind of an ordination into doing what I'm doing today.
Yeah.
So when you ask the question, Would I have ever chosen this? No.
Right.
But God heard my heart's cry.
Yeah.
I didn't want to just write music that tickled people's ears and mm-hmm. and like, you know, their emotions. I wanted to write something deeper that moved their that touched them deep in their spirit. And God answered my prayer.
Yeah.
So what I'm doing today, I look back at it and think, wow. And what? I was just in my hometown the last few days in Two Harbors, Minnesota. And I just was there and...
See how far you've come.
Well, and I was thinking, how did I... all the little decisions I made along the way that got me to where I am today, mm-hmm. I'm not sure, you know... At the time you're making those decisions, you think nothing of them. But when you get on the other side of it, oh my goodness!
Exactly. It was a pivotal
moment.
What
if I would have turned left?
Yeah.
Rather than turning
right.
But
wasn't it Terry Law who one day said to you, "You are going to lead worship," and you said, "Not me."
Yeah, I mean, yeah, Terry pushed me into that role.
He pushed you into it.
Yeah, he pushed me.
You were terrified, as I recall.
I did a little teaching. A couple of weeks ago on don't disparage the people that God puts in your life that push you out of your comfort zone.
Yes.
Because it's like, what, you get up there and sing, I said, yeah. I don't want to do
I
that.
I know, you didn't want
I'm
it.
I'm not that guy. And he goes, somebody needs to give you a good swift kick in the rear to get you doing what God's called you to do. So yeah, good. I had people pushing me, and I'm very grateful to Terry and others that pushed me out of my comfort zone. And got me doing, it got me out there beyond what I think Don Moen could do, you know.
Yeah.
I'm blessed.
What a beautiful story for all of us to know that at some point God's going to take us, if we'll allow it, if we'll surrender our lives truly, that he'll take us into our destiny and what he's called us to do. And you really have to listen and obey and be willing, you know, to just serve how he wants you to serve. And so somewhere along the line, Don meets Mike Coleman, and at this point, let's just send a special greeting to Mike. I hope he sees this video. Mike, we love you. You're an awesome man of God, and I know he's taught me a whole lot.
Another guy that pushed me out of my comfort zone.
He pushed you out, so how did that happen?
We did, I was 1983 or 84, Terry Law and I went through Mobile, Alabama, and had a service at Mike's church.
Ah.
And Mike was just thinking about, it was before Hosanna music, before Integrity music. But we made the connection, and in 1986, I led worship on a project called Give Thanks.
Which I love that album.
Yeah, which Mike, I remember him saying to me, "This could sell as many as 50,000 units." Well, it sold well over 1 million units.
Yep.
But that was, again, pushing me out of my comfort zone. And that led to our relationship developing. And in 88, I moved to Mobile, Alabama.
In 1988.
In 88, yeah, for so almost 20 years.
So 20 years with Mike and 15 years with Terry Law.
Yeah, that's pretty much my life.
That's, but what a legacy.
Yeah.
And I've watched people, I just watched the Gospel Music Association honor, which I'm a board member of, and they honored Don for his life's work and paid homage to not only the people you've trained and touched, but the music you've written. If you've never heard the album Give Thanks, get it on Amazon or donmoen.com or iTunes, wherever you get music, download it, put it, and just listen to the whole album while you're driving somewhere. I promise you, your car will fill up with the presence of God. It's one of my favorite albums. And so tell me your top five songs that you've written. What are your top five?
That I think?
Yeah.
I Want to Be Where You Are.
Oh,
probably
beautiful.
My favorite. God Will Make a Way.
God Will Make a Way. To save me from many a... hard moment.
I Am the God That Healeth Thee.
Mm-hmm.
Probably I Will Sing.
Yeah,
that's an interesting song that I wrote out of a prayer.
Yeah,
writing down And the words, when I wrote it out, I thought, I can never sing this song. It says, Lord, you seem so far away, a million miles or more, it seems today. And though I haven't lost my faith, I must confess right now that it's hard for me to pray. But I don't know what to say, and I don't know where to start. But as you give the grace, with all that's in my heart, I will sing, I will praise. So that's, I love that song. And
so good.
You know, we put a lot, and our Father, probably the Lord, our Father, we put a lot of this on one good resource we have is the DonMoen.tv, the YouTube
channel. .tv, okay.
Yeah, and that's, you know, I'm touring, I'm doing as much as I can touring-wise, but boy, touring is hard work, and I can't, even if the crowd is 100,000 people.
Right.
It's just limited by just the physical aspects of it. Mm-hmm. But the YouTube channel, we're recording a lot of these things, a lot of teaching, a lot of training, a lot of things like Ask Don. Mm-hmm. And these are some of the things. So for it's all free stuff. So that's DonMoen.tv. A lot of stuff for your worship team and worship leaders as well. Songwriting. So, you know, just take advantage of that stuff. We're putting it up every single week. But,
So if you know, our customers obviously are using MediaShout, they're in the booth, you know, they could have multiple ways of presenting the gospel. But we make church presentation software, and these are 80,000, users of our product. If a church wanted you to come and teach their worship team, and by the way, tell your pastors, when you have training for your worship team, have your media team with them. Can you do that? To go to a church just for teaching and
sure.
evening service of worship?
Yeah, I'm doing much more of that these days. I mean, I love traveling with the band just because it's fun for me, but the reality is, these days, you know, with tight budgets, you know, you bring in a whole band.
It's expensive.
It's going to, especially internationally, it's going to be expensive. But
yeah.
So I've, 20 years ago, I wouldn't have done a lot of things by myself because I'm too afraid to be up there all by myself. But I don't know. I'm just more comfortable doing that these days. So depending on where your budget is, to come in and share it with we can do an evening of worship.
Yeah.
We can just do teaching and training to the worship team. But yeah, by all means, media team, that's such a vital part of worship these days. It's all visual.
It is.
It's become so visual.
Yeah.
And we have to learn not to lose sight of what the main thing is. The main thing is to connect the people with God's presence. So let's use everything we can. But I'd love to talk to teams about that.
Yeah.
And I've been around the block. I've been doing this a lot of years now.
Yeah, you know.
And I've learned some things. And guess what? I'm still learning things. So I love doing that stuff. We got a series of eight called the Master Series, where I'm teaching on stuff like this. So that's all on the website, but it's all teaching about songs, teaching about how do you rehearse your band? Mm-hmm. The importance of sound engineering. You know, one thing that you might be surprised at, if you build a church that's gonna cost $1 million, the rule of thumb is that at least 10% of that needs to be designated to sound. And people, what, $100,000 for a sound thing? But if you build a big facility and the people, you have no room for, you haven't thought through the visuals and the sound reinforcement, people are going to be frustrated. It's not going to work. So, yeah, we've got a whole series about that, you know, called the Don Moen Masters Series, but teaching about all those practical things. I love the spiritual aspect of it. I know you do, Eric. Love spontaneous flowing with the Spirit, but there's just a lot of practical things.
Yeah.
Not everybody is comfortable saying just flow with the Spirit. well, what does that mean? So, you know, there are a lot of practical aspects about this, and what I found is Jesus was very practical as well in what he did.
It's like how I travel on vacation. I have a plan. I have dinner reservations every night. I have a hotel booked. I have a backbone of a plan. But when I get there, I allow myself the privilege of changing the plan as the Spirit moves, you know, but at least you've got a plan.
Right, and I found that the more people, it's easier for you to do when you're maybe just by yourself or a small group, but when you get a whole media team involved, you get a whole church involved, you get a whole band involved, the more people that are involved, the more detailed the plan has to be.
Yes.
And the bigger the challenge is to not let that plan drive everything.
Yeah.
That's a real challenge, right. But it's
part of it.
Have
a plan, but also be willing to be flexible. Well, I could talk to Don for hours, and I've done it. He's a wonderful, wonderful hang. We have so many. I have so many great memories. I don't know if Don does or not, but I have so many wonderful memories of hanging out at his home and on the road and talking and laughing.
Going to Armenia. You were on that trip, weren't you?
The Yerevan trip to Armenia. Oh, my God.
We brought out 200 worship leaders out of Iran.
Right.
Because they could fly into Yerevan, Armenia.
Yeah.
I mean, that was... That's another episode we got to talk about.
We should do that episode on worship training.
You think about that today.
It's fascinating.
Where they are, I mean, what they're going through these days.
And they were so grateful.
And I'm thinking about the investment into those worship leaders and pastors to bring them out.
Yes.
To fly them out and to have a worship seminar. Man, amazing.
It was
amazing.
That Pat Lanza, our good friend, funded, but she funded, so we paid all their expenses, brought them to Armenia for this worship training experience, and the worship that let loose that night was very, very, it was just like a little bit of heaven dropped in on earth. And our trip to Brazil and all the wonderful things we've
done. Were you in Cyprus as well then, too?
Not Cyprus, no.
Okay.
But I got to Brazil, Brasilia and Sao Paulo. Oh, God, we have stories. Thank you for listening, and I hope you got something out of it. I can't tell you enough. Please don't let this generation of experience and wisdom about worship and about the Holy Spirit and God's plan and the Bible be lost. Have someone like Don Moen come to your church to teach your worship team and your communications team, whoever's in the booth, whoever's working your church presentation software. Have Don Moen or people like him bring their wisdom. But definitely, if you're going to have Don, have a great dinner the night before with him and those people, because you will laugh. He has stories to tell. You'll laugh all night and have a wonderful time. Don, I love you.
Love you, too.
You are one of my favorite people in the world, and your music has touched my life in ways I can't explain. I mean, I knew your voice and your worship years before I met you, and I remember when I first met you, I was working for World Vision, and we had dinner together, and I was starstruck. But those albums and those five songs that you mentioned helped me get through so many rough times. So I thank you for that. I know one of your ulterior motives for coming here today is you've been trying for years to get me to do a duet album with you. And you've tried and you tried, and I'm just not going to do it. I just want you to know.
Nothing I can do to
convince you. There is nothing. I will not do this duet album with you, and I know that even today, I know it's on your mind.
But God will make a way.
All right, I'll do it.
Where seems to be now.
I love you.
Love you too.
Thanks, MediaShout users. Love you too. Go to donmoen.com and donmoen.tv and bring him to your church. Thanks for listening.